This simple design demonstrates basic concepts of PSPL interaction, clock distribution, and I/O control in a Zynq UltraScale Plus MPSoC system. The processing system block serves several important roles, although its full functionality is not explicitly detailed in the diagram. Here are the key functions of the PS block. Clock generation. The primary visible role of the PS in this design is to generate and provide the clock signal for the programmable logic. This clock is crucial for driving the logic in the PL section. Let's break down how this system works step by step. Processing system to programmable logic clock. The PS provides a clock signal to the PL section. This clock is typically derived from the PS phase locked loop. The PS contains multiple PLLs for clock generation. The PS PLL can generate various frequencies. In this case, one of these PLLs is configured to generate the 100 MHz clock. Counter in programmable logic. A 27-bit counter is implemented in the PL. The counter's output is a binary number that represents the count of clock pulses. Slice block. Slice block is used to extract specific bits from the counter's output. LED control. The extracted bit from the slice block is used to control the LED. When the extracted bit is high, the LED turns on. When the bit is low, the LED turns off. The frequency at the LED blinks is determined by the bit extracted from the counter. The blinking LED makes it easy to visually verify the operation of the programmable logic design. Let's start to create the Vivado design. First, launch the Vivado. Once it's open, click on Create Project and choose a name and location for your project. Select RTL Project and check the box that says Do Not Specify Sources at this time. Now, in the default part window, switch to the Boards tab. Here, we'll select the ZCU104 evaluation board. This selection is crucial as it loads the correct board files for our project. These board files are located in your Vivado installation directory. They contain XML files that describe the board's components, interfaces, and preset configurations. Using these files ensures that we have the correct pin assignments and default settings for the selected board. Create block design. With our project set up, let's add the Zynq UltraScale Plus IP. In the flow navigator on the left, click on Create Block Design. Adding Zynq UltraScale Plus IP. Once the diagram opens, click on Add IP and search for Zynq UltraScale Plus MPSoC and double-click to add it to your design. You will see a banner appear at the top of the diagram suggesting to run block automation. Click on Run Block Automation, select Apply Board Preset, and click OK. This process configures the IP with preset parameters that match the ZCU104 board layout. Let's take a moment to appreciate what this automation has done for us. It's configured the processing system interface to match the ZCU104 board layout. The DDR4 memory controller is set up for the onboard 4 GB DDR4 memory. High-speed interfaces like USB 3 and DisplayPort are configured according to the board design. Low-speed interfaces such as UART, I2C, and SPI are mapped to the correct pins. All these configurations align perfectly with the ZCU104 schematic, saving us a significant amount of time and reducing the chance of errors. Exploring peripherals and schematic. Now, let's explore the peripherals in our design. If we expand the Zynq UltraScale Plus IP block, we can see all the interfaces that have been configured. Each of these interfaces corresponds directly to components and connections on the ZCU104 schematic. When you choose Block Automation and apply Board Preset in Vivado, the selected multiplexed I/O pins indeed match the schematic as shown in the images. Quad SPI. The preset selects MIO 0 to 5 for QSPI, which matches the schematic in image. SD card. The preset chooses MIO 46 to 51 for SD card interfacing, aligning with the schematic in image. Gigabit Ethernet MAC. The preset selects MIO64 to 75 for Gem 3, corresponding to the schematic in image. This covers the various transmit and receive lines needed for Ethernet communication. UART. The preset configures MIO 18 to 19 for UART 0 and MIO 20 to 21 for UART 1, matching the schematic in image. This sets up the transmit and receive lines for both UART interfaces. I2C. The preset selects MIO 16 to 17 for I2C1, which aligns with the information provided in image. CAN bus. The preset chooses MIO 24 to 25 for CAN bus 1, matching the schematic details in image. Understanding this concept is so important when you work with boards that are not provided with the board files. For such boards, you need to set each peripheral manually one by one. You will need to read the schematic carefully and set the MIO pins based on the provided information. We will practice that in 1 hour trainings. Let's come back to Vivado and continue our design. Add a counter and a slice. Add a counter and change its bit width to 27 bits. Connect the clock of the counter to the PL clock 0. Add a slice block to make the last bit of the counters as output. Make the slice's output as external pin. Deselect high-performance master ports. Go to the PSPL interface, master interface option, and then deselect both HPM ports. For this design, we don't need the HPM ports, but in future, when want to connect ASCII blocks to processing system, we will use them. Validate and wrap up. Validate the design and add the top wrapper, and let the Vivado to manage and auto-handle it. Generating the bitstream. Run synthesis design and wait until the synthesis is finished. Open synthesize design and open I/O planning. Assign the proper pin for output to the LED and save it as a constrain file. You can find the GPIO LED from schematic or board files. Save the selected setup for I/O pins as a XDC constraint. Now you are ready to generate the bitstream. Click on Generate Bitstream and wait until it's completed. Exporting the hardware. The last step in Vivado is to export our hardware design for use in Vitis. Go to File, then Export, and then Export Hardware. And make sure to check the Include Bitstream option. The Xilinx Support Archive, or XSA, is a file that contains all the necessary information to transfer our design from Vivado to Vitis. Our Vivado design is divided into two main sections, the processing system, or PS side, and the programmable logic, or PL side. The PS side is configured using the Zynq UltraScale Plus IP block. This block allows us to set up various components of the processing system, including peripherals, ARM cores, PLLs, and ASCII ports. The configurations made in the Zynq IP block are crucial for defining how the PS interacts with the PL and external devices. The PL side is where we implement our custom logic using the FPGA fabric of the Zynq UltraScale Plus. In this example, our PL side includes a binary counter and a slice module that blinks the user LED. When we export the design, the XSA file bundles together all the configurations for both the PS and PL sides. For the PS side, it includes an HWH file, which describes the hardware setup, and multiple initialization files, such as PSU init, which configure peripherals and clocks. For the PL side, the XSA includes the bitstream file, which programs the FPGA fabric. This process creates a Xilinx Support Archive XSA file, which includes the hardware description, PS configuration, and PL bitstream. This file is the bridge between our hardware design in Vivado and our software development in Vitis. For better understanding, you can right-click on the XSA file and extract it to a directory. You will find that the XSA contains bitstream to program the PL side and multiple PS initialization files. These initialization files follow the processing system IP setup in Vivado. Vitis will program and set up the ARM cores based on these selected setups. This is how the setups in Vivado are transferred as initialization files to the Vitis. This concludes part one of our tutorial on creating the Hello World project in Vivado. In the next video, we'll continue by setting up the Vitis project. Don't forget to subscribe, then you don't miss part two. Also, feel free to share your thoughts or questions in the comments below. We'd love to hear from you.